special treat today to be able to experience this with Bill and his family. 95 years young and going strong. And congratulations. Our scripture today is multifaceted. The main verses are Philemon, verses 8 through 17. There's only one chapter, one little chapter book. And there'll be other things in your worship folder. There's a place to list other scriptures for your continued study during the week. Be sure to take advantage of that also. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, take these next few moments, the words of my mouth, the meditations in our hearts, the thoughts in our minds, and truly work to do your miracle to move us forward in life because of what you're about to do in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Today our theme is a special power from God. Do you know the greatest power in the world that you've been given? There are many, many powers. Today we're going to talk about one of those. And it's actually due to the fact that we were created in the image of God, that we have this power. And in Philemon, it starts in verse 8 saying, therefore, although in Christ, I could be bold and order you to do what you ought to do, yet I appeal to you on the basis of love. Now, Paul wrote this letter on behalf of Onesimus. He was a runaway slave who had wronged his owner, Philemon. The details are unstated, although it's assumed that Onesimus fled after stealing money, since Paul states in verse 18 that if Onesimus owes anything, Philemon should charge this to Paul's account. Sometime after leaving, Onesimus came into contact with Paul. He may have been arrested and imprisoned alongside Paul, and may have previously heard of Paul's name as he was, his owner was a Christian and had traveled to him for help. After meeting Paul, Onesimus became a Christian believer. An affection grew between them, and Paul would have been glad to keep Onesimus with him. However, he considered it better to send him back to Philemon with an accompanying letter, which aimed to effect reconciliation, of bringing together again between them as Christian brothers. The preservation of this letter suggests that it was granted, or we probably wouldn't have that saved to be in the Bible today. This letter is addressed to Philemon, Apphia, and Archippus, and the church in Philemon's house. And Philemon is described as a fellow worker, and it's assumed he lived in Colossae in the letter of Colossians. He talks about it there also, and these would be like his wife and his son and this group of people in the house. Now, this is important because in the days of slavery, back in the Bible days, you could tell somebody pretty much what to do, and they had to do it. But Paul wanted to go beyond that and say, you know, I can order you and tell you what to do, all this stuff, but we need to have this thing based on love. So I then, as Paul, an old man now, also a prisoner of Christ Jesus, I appeal to you for my son Onesimus, who became my son while I was in chains. Formerly he was useless to you, but now he has become both useful to both you and to me. I'm sending him, who is my very heart, back to you. I would have liked to keep him with me so that he could take your place in helping me while I'm in the chains for the gospel. But I did not want to do anything without your consent, so that any favor you do will be spontaneous and not forced. This has been a central theme with God since he created us. He wants to give us the power to decide, which is one of the most precious powers and the most powerful things there is, the ability to decide and make decisions. And so today, when you woke up, you did have some things to decide about. And you always have that every day. What a great gift it is. You know, he could have made us puppets, telling us exactly what to do. But he created us in his image as free creatures. We can do anything we want to, but we also have to pay the consequences. When we're a baby, most of our decisions were made for us, and we grew, we had more of these, and began to mature into being responsible for our decisions. But being a decision maker can be a terrible, paralyzing thing. Have you ever stood there before and been totally unable to make a decision because you just couldn't bear it anymore? It's too much to hold in the balance. The choice of a life's made. All of these things may paralyze us. Why are we so hesitant to make these decisions? Why is it that that's such a big thing in our life? One reason is we're afraid we'll make the wrong decision. I obviously made the wrong decision in trying to get that block out of the middle. I should have unstacked it, gone down to it, changed it, and put it back up. But I didn't. Another is that we know that we're responsible for our decisions. Grandma, Grandpa can't make the decisions for us. Our cousin Fred, our neighbor down the street, a deacon, a pastor, a church member. None of those people can decide for us. Each day we are responsible. And we need a definite guide. It says in the fruits of the earth, all our life long we have been tormented by the uncertainty of our past. How can I put it? All choice, when one comes to think of it, is terrifying. Liberty then, when there's no duty to guide it, is terrifying. So he gives us the power to decide. And then he tells us what to do and gives us a guide. In Luke chapter 4, verse 6, it says, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not do what I say? As we look into these scriptures, we know that we are faced with decisions. All other decisions, though, in our life hang on one major decision. What will you do with Jesus Christ? Every day when we wake up, we must think about what we will do with Jesus Christ. God has forgiven us for our wrong decisions to turn away from Him. He's already done it. He forgave us through Jesus the Son, dying for our sins. He's lifted Him up from the grave. And yet, as free creatures, we must choose to either accept that or not. Matthew 19:6 says, just then a man came up to Jesus and asked, Teacher, what good thing must I do to get eternal life? And so he began talking to him about that, and finally he said, if you want to be perfect, go, sell your possessions, give to the poor, and you will have treasures in heaven. Then come, follow me. And he went away sad. He made the wrong decision. He said, go. We must always take action. He puts before us a decision. We must act. And then he says, sell. We must sell out to whatever it is that's holding us back in our life. Perhaps we want to be a better Christian, but some things we're holding on to is we're clinging to. We can't be a better Christian if we hang on to that. And the decision comes where we sell it. And will we give it away? And will we turn ourselves over 100% to Christ and come follow Him? This particular young man went away sad. He wasn't willing to do that. It's our decision to make. If you're running a company, it may be good to delegate some decisions, but ultimately, it's your decision. Who will my master be? Who will I surrender to? Abraham in the Bible, you remember, was pounding. His heart was like, oh my God. He thought God wanted him to sacrifice his son. He had his son there on the altar, and he was sweating, and he was ready to do it. He was going to sacrifice his own son. And then God said, no, I really don't want that. I just wanted to see if you were willing to do that. I wanted your commitment, not your son. I'm giving up my son for you. And so he provided the lamb and the bushes, and then we know the rest of the story. Don't delay your decisions today. Don't delay them. A quarterback that waits too long in the pocket to throw the football, sometimes he finds out, should have gone ahead and thrown it. That big 300-pound lineman comes crushing down on top of him. What are you waiting for today in your life? What decisions are facing you? There was a donkey that stood between two wonderful piles of hay. And he looked at that hay and thought, Lord, it looks good. And then the other one caught his eye over here. That looks good. And the donkey could not decide which hay pile he wanted to eat. So he went over here and he went back and forth so long that he starved to death. God is providing you an answer many times. And you get distracted going from this one to this one, this one to this one. And you can't make a decision. Today we must examine, particularly in Lent, what it is about us that we're afraid to decide. What is it that God's calling us to do, calling us to give up? calling us to become a new person, to take on a new responsibility or adventure. What is it? And are we willing to say yes to God? One of my favorite poems by Robert Frost, "Two roads diverged in a yellow wood, and sorry I could not travel both, and be one traveler long I stood, and looked down one as far as I could to where it bent in the undergrowth. Then took the other, that's just as fair, and having perhaps the better claim, because it was grassy and wanted wear, though as for that, the passing there had warned them really about the thing. And both that morning equally lay in leaves no step had trodden black. Oh, I kept the first for another day, yet knowing how way leads to way, I doubted if I should ever come back. I shall be telling this with a sigh, somewhere ages and ages hence. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that's made all the difference. Today, what are you doing with the decisions that you have to face? Are you holding back? Are you willing to move forward? You have the power to decide in your life. No one can do it for you. Are you still struggling with surrendering your life to Christ? Are you maybe putting on a show for your friends and neighbors, but you know in your heart you've really not surrendered? You aren't willing to go all the way for Christ? Or is it a part of your Christian journey that you know you need to be perhaps giving more, or working more, or reaching out more, or something's calling you over here but you won't say yes to? We struggle with these every day. Your personal spiritual growth. You know you need to read the Bible more, but you're not willing to make that decision yet. You need to pray more, and you aren't willing to do that yet. What is it that God's speaking to you about today? What will we do with Jesus? Where will we decide to stand? In Ezekiel chapter 36, verses 26 and 27, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. I will take the heart of stone out of your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes. And you will keep my judgments and do them. Two simple verses. And these two verses of what each person needs now, not only in this congregation, or this community, or this state, or this nation, or this world. When you go out in space and you look back on this globe, it's one little ball of atmosphere. And we're all dependent on each other. And the only way we'll ever come together is through the love of God, and He's provided Christ to bring us together. How's your heart today? Are you holding something against a neighbor? He will take that heart of stone away. How about your boss somewhere? Maybe you've got a little thing going with your boss, or your mate, or your children. This scripture applies to each of us right where we are. Do you need a new heart and a new spirit within you? Do you need to be softened up to live like a Christian in this world? I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes. And you will keep my judgments and you will do them. Today I encourage you, particularly during this time of Lent, to make the right decisions. You're the only one that's been given that power in your life. And no one else can do it for you. It's a wonderful power. Take the road less traveled, the one you've not been doing, the one that you've been holding back on, and it'll make all the difference down the road. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we're so grateful that you saved these scriptures for us today. We're so grateful that we can look into this so many years after they were written, and you preserved them, so that we know that you called heaven and earth to witness to us, and you set before us the ways of life and death and blessing and curse, and you've asked us to choose life, and so many times we choose death and curse. You created us in your own image, and you made us different than all other creatures so that we could know you and know ourselves, that we're really a person that's been created in your image, and yet sometimes we don't take that. And Lord, you've advised us to live our lives according to your Holy Spirit, so we won't be doing what your sinful nature craves within us, and the devil tries to make us do it. We can't blame the devil. The devil can't make us do it, because greater is you who is in us than in the world. So enable us to claim you, to receive you, and move away from these two forces constantly fighting, and help us to be free from this conflict by surrendering today to you. Enable us to move to beneath the cross of Jesus and take our stand there and be proud to stand underneath this cross and to go forth and be the person, the man, the woman, the child that you want us to be in this world. Help us not to delay, but make that decision now. In the name of Christ, we pray that for the sake of Jesus Christ, that that sacrifice would not go in vain on our lives. Amen. Our final hymn of commitment is hymn number 151. I invite you to make your decisions now. And if there are decisions you'd like to share with the body of Christ, feel free to come and share that, and we can rejoice with you. The first and last verse, 151, beneath the cross of Jesus.